Rise. Good morning. We're going to start off the service with a prayer of thanks for the fathers. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there. And so let's go to God in prayer. We give thanks, Creator God, for the fathers in our lives. Fatherhood does not come with a manual. And reality teaches us that some fathers excel while others fail. We ask for your blessings for them all and forgiveness where it is needed. This Father's Day, we remember the many sacrifices fathers make for their children and families and the ways, both big and small, they lift children to achieve dreams thought beyond reach. So too, we remember all those who have helped fill the void when fathers pass early or are absent. Grandfathers and uncles, brothers and cousins, teachers, pastors and coaches, and the women of our families. For those who are fathers, we ask for wisdom and humility in the face of the task of parenting. Give them the strength to do well by their children and by you. In your holy name, O God, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, why don't you stand and let's join together in singing to our Heavenly Father, the hope of the ages. The gospel of Jesus is the hope of the ages, burning brighter and brighter and standing forever. The church he is building, nothing can stop it. It's a city that's shining, a light in the darkness. Nothing can stop it.
Forever, yeah, all praise belongs. You can all take a seat. I want to welcome you this morning, this Father's Day, to Sunrise Church. If you're a guest or a visitor, we welcome you and hope you have a time where you meet Jesus, because that's really what it's all about. And for those of you watching online, we welcome you also. Steve, you can come up. Dan Kuiper's going to be bringing the message today. I think he was here on Mother's Day, so he's back on Father's Day, so he gets all the special days. I could be wrong about that. And Steve's got an announcement.
Jerry Danke has graciously opened up his cottage up on Leech Lake. It's in north central Minnesota. And he's opened it up for a week long of fishing and fellowship with the men of this congregation. If anyone is interested, please see me after the service out in the narthex, and I can give you more information on it.
And always remember that a bad day of fishing is better than a good day at work. Trust me, I know that. And I also want to remind you, we have our congregational meeting after church to select the new elders and deacons. So if you're a member, you can come and vote. And if you're not a member and you're curious to see how we do things, you're more than welcome to come and observe. We'd appreciate that. So now you can stand, greet each other, and say hello. Morning. No, I don't. Thank you.
To welcome all my VBS kids. All my Zoomerang kids can come on up front. And the rest of you may have a seat. I would like to call all my Zoomerang friends up front. We're going to share with you what we did this week. All my Zoomerang friends. And as they do come up, I just want to say a big thank you. I just brought a stack of thank you cards that was like this thick of people that volunteered to help this week. And I know that wasn't it. I know there was a lot of people that were praying for this week, and I know there was also a lot of people that donated food and resources, and I know a lot of you donated your time. And instead of naming off everybody, because I know I'm going to miss someone, I just want to say thank you. And from these kids, thank you too. So what we would like to do this morning is just show you a few things that we learned this week. So we're going to share a couple songs with you. Here we go. Can you guys say this first?
There's a... There's a kangaroo, platypus, dingo, emu, koala up a tree. Wombat, numbat, cricket bat, redback, so many critters to see. Bandicoot, lorikeet, kookaburra, ha-ha, brain coral, living in the sea. Flying fox, there's a croc, clownfish, the most wonderfully made is me.
Wonderfully made, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a wombat.
What a great God, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a dingo.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we ain't just talking about another branch on the family tree. We're talking about a different tree.
We're talking about trees. Thought we're talking about animals. Animal trees.
Just sing the song, mate. Bit faster this time.
There's a kangaroo, platypus, dingo, emu, koala up a tree. Wombat, numbat, cricket bat, redback, so many critters to see. Bandicoot, lorikeet, kookaburra, ha-ha, brain coral living in the sea. Flying fox, there's a croc, clownfish, the most wonderfully made is me.
Wonderfully made, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a wombat.
What a great God, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a dingo.
Oh, yeah.
We're made different. For example, have you ever heard a camel try and sing?
No, but birds can sing.
Fair point. Very repetitive lyrics, though. Let's try it faster.
There's a kangaroo, platypus, dingo, emu, koala up a tree. Wombat, numbat, cricket bat, redback, so many critters to see. Bandicoot, lorikeet, kookaburra, ha-ha, brain coral living in the sea. Flying fox, there's a croc, clownfish, the most wonderfully made is me.
Wonderfully made, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a wombat.
What a great God, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a dingo.
Wonderfully made, I'm so wonderfully made.
Different than a wombat.
What a great
wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. I pray.
Friends, you can go ahead and go back to your seats. You're going to go ahead and go back to your seats, and then after the offering, you're going to head out for children's worship, okay?
Just a minute. Hey, Guy, you can stay up here for a little while longer, kids, just for a moment. Kelly, stand up. Okay, Ben, you can go. And then Kendra here. And Megan, you can come up too.
Mrs. Van Dyne. All the kids of Sunrise would like to thank you for all the work you have done for us. We would like to give you these flowers.
Oh, we're not done. Come back. Nate, why don't you come on up too? Was that a blessing to you? If you haven't heard yet, they're moving to Georgia. I was trying really hard not to get to this point. But we are just so thankful for all that you've done for our church over these years. You have blessed us so much, all of you. We know that you guys are going to be amazing in Georgia, and God's going to use you in incredible ways, and we look forward to hearing about it. I hope that you'll let us know what's going on in your lives and keep us up to date. But just thank you for all of your service in our church, for the children, for the MOPS group, and all the behind the scenes doing the cameras for us. We're just so incredibly grateful for this family, and we're going to miss you.
Come on up here. We need to have a group hug prayer. So anybody would like to, come on up here. Need you up here. Don't be shy. We got all morning. Come on down here, kids. Come on down here. We're waiting if there's anybody else. Don't be shy. Can touch each other. That's legal. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Christ our Savior, the Holy Spirit, be with us now as we wish a farewell to Nate and Kelly and their family. We love them so much. We know Georgia's waiting on them. What a blessing to Georgia. They've been a blessing to us. Help your light to shine through them and all these young ones that they have blessed and all us old folks that they have blessed. We love them. We wish them well. We're so blessed as a church to be here together as a group, touching each other and loving each other. Thank you, Lord. You're beyond our comprehension. Help us to know that and understand that and yet be blessed by that. help your light to shine through Kelly and Nate, not only at their church setting, but every moment that they touch other lives. We love them dearly. We praise you, God, for giving us to them for a while and them to us. Forgive us for our sins. Help us to do better each and every day. We love you and we praise you. Amen.
All right, yeah, now the kids can go sit down. Is it this time? Thanks, Larry. It's at this time in the service that the deacons will collect the offering, and the offerings are simply our way of giving back to God the part of what's already His. If you're a guest or a visitor, you don't need to put anything in the plate. Just take this service as our gift to you, and enjoy the video while we're taking the offering.
Yay, God, huh? Well, it's Father's Day. Kids, children's worship is at 3 through first grade. You're dismissed now to go. Children's worship is open for the kids now. It being Father's Day, and it's fine. I would like all the fathers to stand up. All the fathers. And I'm gonna pray a prayer for the fathers, and then I'm gonna ask all the fathers to just reach out and pray for someone, a sentence prayer or two when I'm done, and then Denny Fisher will close us and pray with a short prayer, okay? Father, I just pray for these fathers. I just pray that your blessing and your favor and your power and your righteousness would rest on these, fathers. I pray for a spirit of strength, a spirit of wisdom, a spirit of discernment. And I just pray that you would give us, these fathers, your eyes to see, your ears to hear, and your heart to receive, and give our feet that we would put into practice what you have told us. I just want to pray that you would give us confidence, courage, strength, endurance, and just an overwhelming, abiding love in you. And I just pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
So just reach out your hand to someone, and everyone, all you fathers, just pray for whoever is around you. Just right now. Sentence or two.
Someone in their life 24/7 to show them how to be a proper man.
Father, we thank you for the celebration of Father's Day and what it means to all of us guys standing here as fathers. And Lord, we look to you because you have blessed us so much. You have given us a plan and a purpose in our lives. And we just thank you that we could carry that plan and purpose out as fathers. We thank you for the powerful presence of your Holy Spirit here with us today, for the songs that we saw the kids sing, a vacation Bible school week that was just so awesome. And thank you, Lord God, for your blessings and presence in this church and our church family. All the visitors who are here today, we are grateful and thankful. Bless them with your presence and love. And we thank you especially for all the children here who are here today to help us in our worship time. We give you all the praise. We give you the glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In your name, amen.
Wow, that was a blessing, huh? We could just go home now. We're not going to, but we could. Happy Father's Day to all you dads here this morning. You know, there aren't many roles more important in this world. Billy Graham once said, a good father is one of the most unsung, unpraised, unnoticed, and yet most valuable assets in our society. And I would add to that, especially in our society today. There just aren't many roles that are more important. You know, our kids are all grown up now, and they're out on their own. We had to give a little nudge to one of them. I told them when we had you baptized, it wasn't till death do us part. But we're empty nesters. We have been for some time. But I still treasure those special moments that we have had through the years, especially as our kids were growing up. I remember when our kids were in grade school, we went on a family vacation to Arizona, and we were hiking the Seven Falls Trail in Sabino Canyon. And we heard that this trail would lead us to some amazing waterfalls. And as a dad, I wanted us to experience that together as a family. And sure enough, after a 4.5-mile trek, there it was, just this incredible display of God's handiwork. It was truly a go God moment that I thought would forever be etched in my kids' memories. Well, it's etched in their memories, all right, but not for the reasons that I had hoped for. You see, as I was having this deeply spiritual experience at the sight of this beautiful scene, our kids were focused on something else, because there on the bank of the falls was a pair of huge wet underwear. Now, I don't even want to think about how they got there or who they belonged to, but within nanoseconds, our son, being a typical boy, had gotten a stick, and he was twirling that wet underwear above his head with his sisters laughing hysterically. And I kept trying to turn their attention to God's beauty, right? But it seems this wet underwear was a much bigger attraction. Finally, I just had enough, and I said, "Greg, that is gross. Put that down." So he flung the underwear off the stick, and it landed on my head, engulfing my entire face. Needless to say, even though this was the vacation in which we saw Seven Falls, the Grand Canyon, we rode in a pink Jeep in Sedona, it will forever be remembered by our kids as the vacation where Dad had wet underwear on his face. Not the kind of family memory this father was hoping for, but it was a memory nonetheless. The truth is, we fathers and mothers will all be remembered by our children. The question is, what will they remember? Will they remember the fun and laughter? Will they remember shouting and fear? Will they remember the time and attention that we gave them? Or will they remember how we weren't there when they needed us the most? This morning, we're going to talk about this whole concept of blessing. And it is my prayer today that we will be remembered as parents who were blessed by God, first of all, but then who passed that blessing along to our families. Now, this whole idea of blessing is becoming more and more uncommon in this world in which we live. We are living in a world of confusion. We are living in a culture that is trying to rewrite God's plan, that is rewriting God's concept of family. It is sad that many don't even know the true meaning of the word family, or father, or mother, man, woman, husband, wife. And that is why it is all the more important that we revisit God's plan for family so we can do it His way, and be a people of blessing. It happened in the 1960s. Steve was a sophomore in high school. His family had moved to a new town, and Steve knew one of the best ways to make new friends was to go out for a sport. Well, basketball was his sport. He really wanted to go out for the basketball team. The problem is, he couldn't. You see, Steve had done something stupid. Because he had goofed around in one of his classes, he had gotten a D on his report card. And his dad's rule for the three boys in the family was very clear. You bring home anything less than a C, you don't get to play sports. Well, one day in PE class, the varsity basketball coach was watching Steve in action on the court, and he went right up to him and said, "I want you to try out for the varsity team." Now, bear in mind, for a sophomore, that was a pretty big deal to play varsity basketball. But Steve kindly told the coach that he couldn't. And when the coach asked Steve why, he told him he couldn't play because of his report card. And the coach said, no. According to school rules, you're still eligible to play if you only got just one D. And Steve said, "Yeah, I realize that, but you need to understand my dad has his own eligibility rules." The coach said, "What's your phone number? I'll call your dad." Steve said, "I'll give you the phone number, but it's going to be a waste of your time." Well, the coach soon found that out to be true. Despite his pleading for Steve to be on the team, Steve's dad simply told the coach it was his job to teach his sons how to be responsible. Then if Steve wanted to play basketball the next season, he knew what he needed to do. Well, the coach kept pushing and pushing, but Steve's dad stood firm. The next morning, the coach went up to Steve in the locker room after PE and told him about the conversation he had with his dad. He said, "Yeah, I talked to your dad yesterday afternoon. He wouldn't budge. I tried to explain the eligibility rules. He wouldn't change his mind. But then," he said, "I don't have very much respect for your father." Steve couldn't believe what he heard. He thought, "You don't respect my father? Even I have enough sense to know that my dad is doing the right thing. Sure, I want to play ball, but I know that my dad is a man of his word, and he is right in not letting me play." So Steve looked at the coach and said, "I want you to know something. I highly respect my dad, and I want you to know I will never play basketball for you." And having learned from his father that a good man is a man who is true to his word, Steve, even though he got his grades up, never did play basketball in high school because he refused to play for a man that didn't respect his father for doing the right thing. And listen to what Steve said later. He said, "My dad was a man of conviction and character, and any coach who couldn't see that was not the kind of man I wanted to be associated with. My dad was strict. My dad was unwilling to change his conviction, even though he had gone to college on a basketball scholarship, and it killed him for me not to play ball. My dad was capable of change, but he was unwilling to change, because he had a long-term objective that the coach didn't have. The coach wanted to win games. My dad wanted to build a son." Now, many in today's world would hear a story like that and vilify the father, right? "Steve's rights are being violated. He should have been able to play if he wanted to." They'd say Steve's dad was wrong. They might even call him abusive. They might say, "There's nothing Christian about denying your son the opportunity to use his God-given talent." That's what the world would say. But the more important question is, what would God say? And based on his word, God would say that Steve's dad did the right thing by being a man who was true to his word, even though his decision came with a price. And God would say that Steve did the right thing by obeying his father. Because the word is very clear. God says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is what? Right." This is right. So Steve's dad actually blessed his son by helping them to learn what it truly means to be a man of integrity, a man who is true to his word. And what makes this story even more powerful is Steve's dad said he just couldn't play basketball his sophomore year. Steve could have played as a junior or senior, but he chose not to. And why? Because the honor Steve had for his dad wouldn't allow it. Let's look further at what God has to say about that. First, he says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Then in the very next verse in Ephesians 6, he says, "Honor your father and mother," which is the first commandment with a promise. And why? "So that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth." Honoring our father and mother is one of the Ten Commandments. And as Scripture says, it's the first commandment that comes with a promise. And please don't miss this. If you honor your father and mother, if you respect their God-given authority, God promises to bless you. You see, when we obey God, we receive his blessing in our lives. Now, what on earth does that even mean? We Christians use that word blessing a lot. We ask God to bless this, bless that. We say, "God bless you," when someone sneezes. We call significant events blessings in our lives. But what exactly does that mean? What does it mean to receive God's blessing? Well, first, let's take a look at what it doesn't mean. God's blessing in our lives doesn't mean financial prosperity. God doesn't say, despite what the health and wealth preachers might say, that if we obey him, he's going to bless us with lots of money and a nice house and a new Corvette. Now, God knows all those things are material. They're temporary. He wants to bless his kids with things that will last, things that have significantly more value. So God blesses us with spiritual blessings that have far more worth. When we obey him, God blesses us with blessings like joy, peace, a clear conscience, the ability to forgive, knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are and forever will be loved by him. And earthly fathers are to bless our children the same way. We're to bless our kids with spiritual blessings that have incredible value, that reflect what our Heavenly Father has done for us. So, dads, how best do we bless our children? We bless our children when we teach them the things of God. We bless them when we teach them what it means to live a Christ-centered life. We bless them when we teach them right from wrong. We bless them when we teach them what it means to have integrity and to be true to your word. We bless them when we teach them that they will receive the blessings of God, blessings they will find nowhere else in this world, like joy and peace, a clear conscience, forgiveness, and love without condition. When they put him first in their lives. That's what good Christian fathers do. But we live in a world that mocks Christian values. We live in a world in which many boys and young men have no clue what it means to be a man, let alone a father. Manhood is under a cultural attack. And we need to be aware of what is going on, friends, because in recent years there's been a huge shift in perception of what a man and a father is. And those of us who follow Christ need to be more committed than ever to stand up for what God says. Let's take a look at what's going on in the world. According to research done by the University of Massachusetts, in the 1950s and 60s, the three words that best describe fathers portrayed on TV and in the movies were wise, caring, and moral. That's how you describe dads on TV and in the movies in the 50s and 60s. Today, in 2022, the top three words to describe fathers portrayed by Hollywood: stupid, incompetent, and clueless. We have gone from father knows best to father doesn't know anything. We know we're in trouble when a recent poll shows that the best father portrayed on TV is Homer Simpson. Men are being neutered in this society, and many of us don't even realize it. And now, more than ever, we Christians need to stand up for what is right. And this is not a matter of right versus left or Democrat versus Republican. This is a matter of good versus evil. And please excuse me if I get riled up about this, but it is time for believers to take a stand. We need to be more concerned about not offending God than we are in not offending each other. We need to get away from the culture's lies and get back to God's truth. We live in a culture that's trying to erase the differences between male and female. Genesis 5:2 makes it clear, male and female, he created them. Two different sexes. Anyone here notice that men and women are different? Boys and girls are different? Men and women have been created differently, and we should celebrate that. And as much as culture tries to tell us that we're the same, there are major, indisputable, biological, physiological differences. And any biologist will tell you those differences between male and female begin as early as 26 weeks in the womb. Fact, men have more muscle mass than women. Fact, men have a better sense of direction than women. Fact, a man's ring finger is generally longer than his forefinger, And a woman's index finger is generally longer than her ring finger. You can check it out now, because I know you're going to be bothered until you get it figured out. A man's ring finger is generally longer than his index finger, and for the woman, it's the other way around. Fact, women feel more pain than men. Fact, blood flows more evenly in a man's system than in a woman's, which is why a woman's hands and feet always get colder. And any husband who shares a bed with a wife can attest to this fact. Fact, women get more startled easier than men. Fact, when faced with making important decisions, women are more inclined to play it safe, men are more inclined to take risks. Fact, women have neater handwriting than men. Fact, women express aggression verbally, men express it physically. People, these are not design flaws. It is how God created us. He created men and women uniquely and wonderfully. The kids just sang that to us this morning. We are wonderfully made. We need never apologize for being what God created us to be. I am proud to be a man. I am proud to be a father. I am proud to be a follower of Jesus Christ. We must be defined not by what the world says we are, but by who God says we are. Now, in my work, I get to travel the country and speak to young people about things like this. I speak to thousands of boys and men about what it means to be a good and a godly man. And the sad thing is, there are a lot of boys and young men in our world today who have no idea what it means to be a good man, because a good man was never modeled for them. Some have dads who left the family. Some have dads who are physically there but emotionally absent. Some had dads who were addicts or alcoholics or who cared more about their job than their family. Some have no idea who their dad even is. Some of you here this morning might be able to relate to that. So I would like to encourage you, don't listen to what the world says. Don't base your idea of a good man on what TV and the movies say. To find out what a good man is, we need to listen to what God says. And here is how he explains in his word what a good man is. A good man is a man of courage and strength. A good man is faithful to the truth and brave in the face of opposition. A good man is persistent through trials. A good man is a man of prayer who lives in complete dependence on and obedience to the will of God. A good man is worthy of respect. And listen to this one. A good man confesses his sin, owns his brokenness, and desires to walk in truth. Dads, do you want to bless your kids? Be that man. And that last one is so important. A good man will confess when he messes up and owns his mistakes. In my work, I often tell dads, saying I'm sorry to your kids can be much more important than saying I love you. Because sadly, there are a lot of people out there who will never admit that they've made a mistake. Because that takes honesty, that takes humility. Now, there's no such thing as a perfect man, a perfect father. But dads, listen, a good man owns his imperfection, acknowledges that he sometimes says and does wrong things. A good man doesn't try to hide his sin. He doesn't blame others for it. I told you about Steve, whose dad wouldn't let him play basketball because he got a D on his report card. Now, there's a couple of things about that story that really stand out to me. First of all, Steve didn't try to hide his report card from his dad. He didn't say to himself, as long as dad doesn't find out, I can still play ball. No, he was honest about it. And secondly, Steve didn't blame his dad that he couldn't play. He didn't say, well, that's a stupid rule. He didn't challenge his dad's authority. He owned the fact that he got a D and he accepted the consequences. And in doing so, he showed his coach what integrity looks like. He honored God. He honored his dad by being obedient. And please don't miss this. He received God's blessing in his life as a result. See, even though he didn't play basketball, he was blessed in that he could hold his head up high knowing he did the right thing. Let me share with you from the Bible a powerful story of blessing. This is a drawing of this encounter. It's a story of a man who was far from perfect, who for years tried to cover up his sin. He tried blaming others, and he found out that didn't work. So finally, he confronted his sin. He owned his brokenness so that he could be a good man and receive God's blessing. The man's name is Jacob. His story is found in Genesis 32, but before I read it, let me set the stage. Jacob was not a good man. Jacob was a deceiver. In fact, that's what the word Jacob means, deceiver. And he was a man who lived up to his name, let me tell you. See, Jacob had a twin brother, Esau, who was the firstborn. The thing is, Esau was, the Bible says, a man of the field. He was a hunter. The Bible says Esau's complexion was red, that he was hairy. He was a man's man. Jacob, on the other hand, was not an outdoorsman. The Bible says Jacob was quiet and mild and liked to dwell in tents. In other words, Jacob stayed inside with the women. Jacob was a mama's boy. Now, it was customary for the eldest son to receive a special blessing from their father. But when Jacob and Esau were grown, Jacob, with mama's help, tricked his father by pretending to be Esau. He wound up deceiving his brother and their dad and stealing the blessing that rightfully belonged to Esau. That resulted in Esau becoming so angry he wanted to kill his younger brother. So Jacob fled. When Jacob reached a place called Haran, the great deceiver met his match in Uncle Laban. Though Jacob fell in love with Laban's younger daughter, Rachel, Laban tricked him into marrying his older daughter, Leah. The deceiver was deceived. Well, Jacob eventually agreed to work many years for Laban so he could have Rachel too, but then he took off, and Uncle Laban was not very happy. Well, God directed Jacob to return to the land of his father. Problem is, now he had to face his brother. As he approached home, Jacob sent messengers ahead just to see if Esau was still ticked off. The messengers returned to him saying, "Yeah, your brother's heading this way with about 400 men. Jacob's life of deceit was beginning to close in on him. Jacob was literally at the crossroads in his life. He had a river in front of him, an angry uncle behind him, an angry brother approaching. And Jacob the deceiver was finally brought to the point in his life where he realizes he doesn't want to be a deceiver anymore. The heading of this passage is Jacob Wrestles with God. From Genesis 32. During the night, Jacob got up, took his family, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He got them safely across the brook along with all his possessions. But Jacob stayed behind by himself, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he couldn't get the best of Jacob as they wrestled, he deliberately threw Jacob's hip out of joint. Then the man said, "Let me go, it's daybreak." Jacob said, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me." The man said, "What's your name?" He answered, "Jacob." The man said, "But no longer. Your name is no longer Jacob. From now on, it's Israel, which means God wrestler. You have wrestled with God, and you've come through." Jacob asked, "And what's your name?" The man said, "Why do you want to know my name?" And then, right then and there, he blessed him. So Jacob named the place Peniel, which means God's face, because he said, "I saw God face to face, and I lived to tell the story." Jacob had come to a crossroads. He could either continue on in his life of deceit, hiding the truth, blaming others, or he could confess his sin, own his brokenness, and seek the blessing of God. He chose plan B, and Jacob got what he wanted on that wrestling mat. He said, I have lived a life of deceit, and I don't want to be a deceiver anymore, and I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. You see, guys, that's what good men do. They don't hide their sin. They don't blame others when things don't go their way. They confess their sin. They own their brokenness. They're willing to do whatever it takes to receive God's blessing in their lives. I stood at a crossroads in my life in the summer of 1987. At that time in my life, it made no sense that I would be such a wreck. One would have thought by looking at me that I had it all. I was happily married, had two wonderful kids, a third on the way, a successful business, and my lifelong prayer had been answered. My dad, after years of abusive alcoholic behavior, had finally found sobriety, and for the first time in my life, I had a good relationship with him. You would have thought I would have been on cloud nine. But instead, I was this close to going completely down in flames. I was miserable. I was depressed. I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. I had these unexplained anxiety attacks. My mind was just bombarded with fear and worry. But perhaps most of all, God was nowhere to be found. It's not that I didn't believe he was there. It's that I believed he didn't care. I questioned his love for me. I was sure that his grace for me had run out, that I just wasn't good enough to receive his blessing. And it sure wasn't for lack of trying. I tried to please him every day. I was frantically trying to do all the right things. I was going to church. I was involved in the church. I was reading his word. I was praying every day. I was following the Ten Commandments, trying my best to earn God's approval, but I always seemed to come up short. And as much as I pleaded with him to let me feel his presence in my life, I felt as if he had abandoned me. I was doing all the right things, but I had no peace. I experienced no joy. And I felt no love. And I couldn't for the life of me understand why. And one day, I was out for a bike ride, contemplating why I should even bother pursuing God, when I passed a church down the street from our house. I happened to know the pastor, and I saw his car in the parking lot. I knew I needed to talk to somebody, and I also knew I couldn't talk to anybody in my church because I didn't want them to know that I wasn't who I was pretending to be. And it was as if God grabbed hold of my handlebars and turned my bike around, and soon I found myself in that pastor's office where I shared with him what was going on, that I was wanting desperately to be the man that God wanted me to be, that I was doing all the right things, that I was trying to get close to God, that I wanted his blessing more than anything, but nothing was working. And even though I knew in my head about peace and joy and love, I didn't feel it in my heart. And I remember saying to him, it's as if my prayers are bouncing off the ceiling like God is a million miles away. And then that kindly pastor asked me a profound question. He said, Dan, when you pray, how do you address God? I said, Father. Then he asked a question that sent me on a quest to discover who God really is. He asked, what does that word father mean to you? Now, even though my dad was now sober, something for which I will forever be grateful, that question instantly brought me back to my childhood. And all those feelings that I tried to hide, repress, and deny my entire life just came rushing to the surface. Feelings of anger and sadness and resentment and rejection. I thought of all the yelling and screaming and accusations. I thought of all the ball games and band concerts and father-son events that my dad missed because he was drunk. And I remembered that gut-wrenching feeling that I just didn't matter. And I looked at that pastor and said, "You want to know what that word father means to me? A father is someone you can't trust. A father is someone you can never please. A father is someone who is angry and critical, who you need to walk on eggshells around. A father is someone who is supposed to love you, but he'd rather be with his drinking buddies than his own son." I'm quite sure he wasn't expecting such a volatile response. But that kind man smiled and leaned forward in his chair and said, "I'm not sure I'd want to pray to a God like that either." And that's when the light bulb went on. The reason God seemed so distant, so disinterested, is I was viewing him through the distorted lens of my dad. I was looking at my heavenly father through the lens of my earthly father. And just as I had spent my childhood trying to earn my earthly father's love, now I was spending my adult life trying to earn my heavenly father's love. That pastor's office was my wrestling mat. It's where I said, "I don't want to go through the motions anymore. I don't want to go through life pretending. I don't want to go through life hiding my feelings of sadness and anger and hopelessness. I don't want to blame my dad or God for anything that goes wrong in my life. I want to find healing. I want to be freed from my past. I wanted to experience God's peace and joy and love in my life. So I said, God, I am not letting you go until you bless me." Bless me, he has. He has taught me the importance of being a man of integrity. He has taught me the importance of being true to God's word and forgiving those who aren't. He taught me the importance of standing up for what is right and standing against what is wrong, even when that's not the politically correct thing to do. He taught me the importance of confessing my sin and owning my brokenness so that I could walk in truth. He has taught me to be proud that I'm not just a man, but I'm a man of God. For the past few years, I've been involved in a men's ministry called Battle Cry, and we put on weekend retreats all around the country where we teach men what it means to be a man and what integrity looks like, where we provide a safe place where we can confess our sin and lovingly hold each other accountable. And we fight for other men when they've never had anyone fight for them before. We fight for them to get God's blessing in their life. And at every Battle Cry retreat I've ever attended, I've heard men say at the end of the weekend that they so enjoyed the experience of being in such a loving, grace-filled environment, but they were afraid to go back in the real world. But then we remind them, as I want to remind you this morning, as Christians, as believers in Jesus Christ, this is the real world. This is how God wants us to live, in honesty, integrity, accountability, holding each other up, carrying each other's burdens, singing of and celebrating God's goodness, praying for his blessing on us, praying for his blessing on others as we did up here in the front just a few moments ago. This, my friends, is the real world. In a few moments, we're going back to the fake world. A world that's turned its back on God. A world of dishonesty, immorality, unaccountability. A world where people tear each other down, where blatant sinful behavior is not only accepted, it's celebrated. And this is why it is all the more important to seek God's blessing in our lives. Whether we are fathers or mothers, men or women, boys or girls, we need God's blessing now more than ever, because we live in a world that needs God's blessing now more than ever. And I know the school year has ended, but I have a homework assignment for you. If you truly want God's blessing in your life, if you, like Jacob, are just done going through the motions, and you truly want a new name and a new walk so you can be the person that God has created you to be, I'm going to invite you to do these three things. Number one, get alone with God. Jacob sent everyone away so he and God could take care of some unfinished business. If we want God's blessing in our lives, we need to get alone with him. And some of you may be saying, who has time for that? If you're too busy to get alone with God, then you're too busy. We will not experience the power of God's blessing until we, like Jacob, have carved out some time to be alone with God. And I'm not talking about prayer time or devotional time or Bible reading time, because this is not about doing. I'm talking about simply being alone with God. It's about being, simply being in his presence. So get alone with God. And secondly, get honest with God. God wouldn't bless Jacob until he was honest about who he was. See, God had wanted to bless him years before, but that blessing was blocked until Jacob got to the point where he admitted his sin and his deceitfulness. Do you want to be blessed by God? Then you need to be honest with God. And isn't it interesting that during their little wrestling match, God asked, what is your name? And that's interesting because Jacob's blind father asked that same question 20 years earlier. What is your name? Jacob lied and said, I'm Esau. This time he's honest. He said, I'm Jacob. He was done pretending. Friends, God is infinitely more pleased with those who admit they sin as he is with those who pretend that they don't. Jacob basically said, I'm a deceiver and I don't want to be a deceiver anymore. If we want God's blessing, we need to be honest about who we are. And after we get alone with God and get honest with God, the third key to God's blessing in our lives, we have to get hold of God. And I mean get hold of God. You see, when Jacob stepped onto that wrestling match to get God's blessing, he was still trying to do it on his own strength. He wanted God's blessing so bad, he said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And God let that go on for quite a while, all through the night, in fact. The Bible tells us that after daybreak, when the match looked like it was going to be a draw, God finally touched Jacob's hip and threw it out of socket. And any wrestler will tell you the thigh is one of the body's strongest parts. That's where a wrestler's power comes from. And that's the part that God touched. And it brought Jacob to a point of surrender. And by the way, Jacob walked with a limp for the rest of his life. God's little reminder of showing Jacob what a changed man he was. When Jacob sent everyone away so he could be alone with God and fight for his blessing, he was Jacob the deceiver who was on the run from his past. But after his divine encounter with God, when he stepped off of that wrestling mat, he went back to his family with a new name and a new walk. My friends, our God wants to do the same with you. Do you want to be remembered as a person, a father, a mother, a son, a daughter, a friend, a teacher, a coach who blessed others in your life, then you first need to receive God's blessing in yours. But you're going to have to fight for it. So get alone with him. Get honest with him. And get hold of him. Don't let him go until he blesses you. And then just watch how he blesses others through you. Let's pray. Oh, Father, what an awesome thing to call you that. Thanks for being our dad. Thanks for being a father who loves us more than we will ever know. A father who delights in spending time with us. A father who created us and accepts us just as we are. A father who wants to change the world through us. Thank you, Father. Thank you. We pray in the mighty name of our Jesus. Amen.
Stand, and we'll respond in song. It's only in Christ alone that we can do these things, right? In the power of Christ.
Blood of Christ.
power of Christ I'll stand. Amen.
I have a closing blessing for you, and something that's always amazed me in church is when a pastor says, receive the blessing, people do this. This is no way to receive anything. Receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And all God's people said, amen.
Go in peace.
Preaching it to you that you could overcome. I still believe it, but it ain't easy. 'Cause that world I painted, where things just don't work.